Okay, on the last video, we talked about address classes, and we talked about subnet mask and what a default subnet mask is. I didn't mention in that last video anything about the CIDR notation. And CIDR notation is just a way to state how many bits are representative of the network mask by using a slash notation. For instance, if you look over here for a Class A address, a default subnet mask is 255.0.0.0. Well, the slash notation for that would be representative in CIDR by using a slash 8, 8 bits being turned on. So there are 8 bits. There are 8 default bits that are used to represent an assigned Class A address. If you look at the Class B, you can convert this CIDR, convert this subnet mask here, 255.255, into a CIDR way to represent it by saying 16 bits, 8 bits, 8 bits. And for Class C, you would represent the exact same number here, 255.255.255.0, as saying slash 24. That's 8 bits turned on in 3 different octets of 8, 16, 24. So basically the CIDR notation is the exact same thing as default subnet mask. It's just a different way to state it. So let's talk a little bit about subnet mask. If I have a address of, let's see, 27.0.0.0, the default subnet mask for that would be what? Well, the way you would answer that is you would look in at this chart here, and hopefully we'll have memorized these borders as far as when the cutoff is from an A to a B and a B to a C. You would look at the chart and you would say, oh, well, that's a Class A address, so a default subnet mask for a Class A address is going to be 255.0.0.0. Or if I want to state it in CIDR notation, I would state it as slash 8. But I don't want to get too much into the CIDR notation right now, so we'll just stick with just the real decimal numbers. Okay, let's say I have an address of 172.86.0.0. The default subnet mask for that number would be 255.255.0.0. And the reason for that is because this is a Class B address, and a Class B address has a default subnet mask of 16 bits or 255.255.0.0. And then, of course, we could look at a Class C address, which and I'm making these numbers up, by the way. This is irrelevant. You know, I can pick any number in that first octet for the classes and do a demonstration on it. Let's say 204.211.14.0. Okay, the default subnet mask for Class C is going to be 255.255.255.0. So you can't look at a network IP address without looking at the subnet mask. And the reason is because, as stated in the other video, routers rely on the accompanying subnet mask to route packets. These default subnet masks are turned on bits that you can't change that are provided to you by your internet authority, the person who gave you your registered IP address. So if the internet service provider gives you one octet and the other three octets are zeros, then they've given you a Class A address, which means you can't use any number in that first octet except for 27. Because you can only use that number 27, you're basically saying, I can't change this number, and the way I'm going to represent that is I'm turning all these bits on. If these bits are on, I can't change it. Same thing here with the Class B. We represent that by saying 255.255. That's the default. Same thing for C is 255.255.255, which represents the network number of 204.211.14.0. Now, we said something a few minutes ago about borrowing bits to make networks. That is subnetting. That is what we do when we subnet a network. What we have the authority over as a network administrator is these three octets here. I can number these three octets however I want to, and I can break a network up into multiple subnets so that I can control network broadcast and collision domains. So we're going to learn later on why that's necessary, why we need to do that. But for now, you just need to know that you can you do a process called borrowing bits, and you can make networks. You can break this big network up of 16,777,214 into multiple networks according to the different size that you need. So the same thing here with the 172.86. I have two octets of numbers that I can create IP addresses however I want to. And we're going to do that, of course, when we do some subnetting. And in the Class C address, I only have one octet. So if you look at this network and host addresses here, these two numbers here are representative of the bits that reflect the network portion of an IP address and the host portion of an IP address. That's something we need to get in the habit of understanding, is there's a network portion and a host portion. This is the network portion of this address. This is the network portion. This is the network portion. The left side represents the network portion depending on how many bits are being used, and the right side, which is represented by zeros, represents your host portion. That is why we have, for Class A, 2 to the 24. Eight bits here is 24 bits. You see that we have a negative 2 here. We'll talk more about this later, but the reason that we have a negative 2 here is because the very first number can't be used and the very last number can't be used, because the first number represents a network number as a whole and the last one represents a broadcast address, which is used by networks to send messages to every host on a network. We'll also talk about that a little bit later on. So no matter what no matter what octet you're working in, or what class of address you're working with, you have to know that the zeros represent host, whereas the other fixed numbers here represent the network portion. That's important because we're going to do an exercise coming up called split the bits. And what split the bits means is we're going to say how many bits represent network, how many bits represent host numbers. Well, a IP address is four octets, 1 byte per octet. 1 byte has 8 bits in it, 8, 16, 24, 32. An IP address is 32 bits, period. Now, of that 32 bits, some of those bits are network bits, and some of those bits are host bits. For this first one here, the 27 represents the network bits. So we are using 8 network bits, and we have 8, 16, and 24 host bits for a total, if you add them together, is the 24 and 8 is 32. So if we come down here and we look at a Class B, a Class B unsubnetted network is represented by 16 bits because we have 8 bits in the first octet, 8 bits in the second octet. So we'll say 16 bits are used to represent network, and then we have two octets that are used for host numbers. So we do slash 16 for that. This is CIDR notation, by the way. It's the same thing as me saying 255, 255 in these octets. We come down here to a Class C. How many bits are the network bits? All of the fixed octets are network bits. So we got this octet, and this octet, which are all fixed bits. So we on a Class C address, 24 bits represent the network, and 8 bits represent the host numbers. All right, this is all default, but when we subnet a network, what we're actually doing is we're going to borrow some bits from the host numbers or the host side of the IP address to make more networks. For instance, let's say on a class, I'm going to use a simple one, on a class C address, I only have 8 bits used unsubnetted for a class C address. That means that I can create excuse me, a range of numbers that start with 0 and end with 256. Well, if you add the 0 and the 256 and the numbers in between, that is a total of 256 physical numbers. But remember, we don't use that first one because that represents our network as a whole, and we don't use the last one. So how many real host numbers do we have? We have 254, which you should see right here. Same thing with a class B address. A class B address, we have 16 bits for host numbers, but if we take 2 bits away, that gives us 14, and 2 to the 14th power is the 65,534, and so forth for the class A. So, as I said, for this exercise, I really just want you to be able to distinguish between a valid subnet mask or an invalid subnet mask. So we're going to leave this right here for now, and we're going to look at some different subnet masks. Okay, let's do a class B address, 172.86.0.0. Okay, unsubnetted, that is going to be 16 network bits. And it's going to be 16 host bits. Alright, what would be the default subnet mask for this? Well, it's class B, so that means we have 2 fixed octets, so a default subnet mask is going to be 255.255.0.0. Okay, well, let's say we're going to subnet this and make this and break this up into into multiple networks. I mean, think about it. If we have a network where we create 65,534 host numbers, then that is one network, and whenever a broadcast has to go out on that network, guess who has to hear it? 65,534 hosts have to hear that. Now, think about a freeway. If the freeway didn't have exits where people could exit off of it to get to a different location, and they all had to stay on the same freeway for a certain length of time, the network, the roadways are going to get congested, traffic's going to get backed up, and it's just going to be a big mess. Well, it's the same thing with networks. If you've got 65,534 hosts listening all the time, then you're creating a traffic nightmare on that network. But if we break this network down into smaller pieces, then we can minimize how much traffic is on each different segment. So that is the purpose of subnetting a network. It is to break networks into smaller pieces, reducing broadcast domains. And whenever you reduce a broadcast domain, you're minimizing traffic. So if we break this down into 4 different subnets, then we could take those four subnets. Everybody on one subnet will hear those broadcasts, but the other 3 subnets don't have to hear it. So let's say we break it down into A, B, C, and D networks. Network A, if a broadcast goes out on network A, then the hosts that are on B, C, and D, they don't have to hear that broadcast. So we're automatically managing the traffic on the network by creating more subnetworks. We're going to get into that a little later. So let's go back to what we were talking about with the valid and invalid subnet mask. Is 255.255.0.0 a valid subnet mask? Yes, it is. All right, let's take the same number, 255.255.0.255. Is that a valid subnet mask? No, it is not. The reason is because the left side of the IP address represents the network numbers. The right side represents the host numbers. You can't have host numbers in the middle of network numbers. So a subnet mask is always going to be represented by network bits and host bits 255.255.0.0. That's valid. Okay. And the highest number that can be in any octet on any address, whether it be subnet mask or IP address, is going to be 255. 255 is all bits turned on. If you look at the chart, when you did the binary chart and you add all those numbers are going to add up to 255. So you can't go beyond that number in any octet. Alright, let's say that you have an IP address of 255.0.0.0. Well, 255.0.0.0 is a valid subnet mask, and the reason is because network bits are on the left, host bits are on the right. But what class address is that? Well, it is a default class A network. I'm going to get rid of this here. It is a default class A network. Why wouldn't we say this is a class B network? Because if it were B, it would be 255.255. And why would we say this is not an A? And why couldn't it be a C? Well, it's not an A because an A is represented by just these bits. So anytime you see this and this, it's a class B. Why can't this be a C? Because if this were a C, then 24 bits are used to represent a class C address. So you can look at a subnet mask and you can determine what class address it is. This is a class C, default class C. Notice I'm emphasizing the word default because we're going to change this up in just a minute. This is a default. 255.255 is a default subnet mask for B. 255.0.0.0 is a default subnet mask for class A. But let me ask you this. If I did subnet this network, I can borrow bits in blocks. And what I mean by blocks is, I'm going to write this chart out that we use for our binary. If you remember, the last number is 128, then 64, then 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, and 1. These bits all add up to the 255. I'm going to try to put the number 2 to the 7th up here. I'm just going to put 7. You'll know that that's 2 to the 7th. And then I'm going to put 6 here. 2 to the 6th, the 5th, 4th, 3rd, 2, wait a minute, let me see, am I doing this right, 1, and 0. Alright, so these numbers up here are the binary powers that we use for the binary math. So if I ask you what is the value of 2 to the 6th power, well, 2 to the 6th power, the value would be 64. What's the value of 2 to the 8th? Well, the value of 2 to the 8th, I mean, I'm sorry, not 2 to the 8th. What is the value of 2 to the 3rd? And the answer is 8. So we have to start looking at these individual powers here. But let's go back to this subnet mask here. 255.255.0.0. Class B default subnet mask. Let's say that I have subnetted this network. And when I subnetted this network, I borrowed bits from the host side of the network. And when you borrow bits left to right. You can't borrow right to left. So let's say I borrowed some bits here and that changes this default subnet mask to 224. Well, let me ask you now, is this still a class B address? Yes, it is. But it can also be a class A, and I'll tell you why. Because if you look at this 2 to the 7th is 128. Remember we said that we subnet in blocks? So any octet of a subnet mask can be 128, or if I add 128 and 64, I get 192. If I add 128, 64, and 32, I get 224. If I add those three numbers and add 16 to it, I get 240. If I add 8 more to that, I get 248. If I add 4 to that, I get 252. And if I add 2 to that, I get 254. That is the most number of bits that can be barred when you're doing subnetting. So if you look at just these numbers right here, these numbers in any octet of a subnet mask gives you the indication that the class address has been subnetted. So 128 is going to be 1 bit barred, 192 is 2 bits barred, 224 is 3 bits barred, 240 is 4 bits barred, 248 is 5, 252 is 6, and 254 is 7. So 7 bits is the most it can be barred out of any octet to make more networks. So back to this number here. Let's say that this is a Class B address. If this is a Class B address, and if 224 is in this third octet, then I should immediately be able to identify that this network had been subnetted. And I should be able to tell you that 3 bits were barred to subnet this network. Because remember, this octet was 0. We bar bits from left to right. If I barred 3 bits to make networks, then I took this bit, and this bit. Add those 3 bits together and you get 224. So that is representative of 3 bits barred on a Class B network. Now, a minute ago I asked you, could this be a Class B or could it be a Class A? It can also be a Class A, because if you had a IP address of let's say 27.15.8.0 with this particular subnet mask, then you would be able to immediately identify, first of all, this is a Class A address. A default subnet mask for a Class A address is 255, but I've got a 255 here and a 224 here. So let's think about that. If I have 255 here on a Class A, then that means these bits were barred. If I have a 224 here, that means some more bits were barred out of this third octet. So the default for Class A is going to be 8 bits. But if you look at this subnet mask here, we've got 8, 16, 17, 18, 19. Because remember we said we barred 3 bits. So we have 19 bits that were barred for networks. So this, if you look at just a subnet mask, you have to make sure you're looking at what that subnet mask goes with as far as the network, because the answer to any question about this subnet mask could be, first of all, it is a Class B address and it has been subnetted, because if it had not been subnetted, this would be 0. Or this could be a Class A address that has 8, 9, 10, 11 bits barred. So that gives us the slash 19 network bits. And then if we have 19 network bits, then the rest of the bits are host bits. So you could easily be tricked by Cisco when they ask you this question. Now I want to ask you, is this a valid subnet mask? Is this a valid subnet mask? No, it is not. because you can have a subnetted octic representative in a subnet mask in the middle. Remember, the bits on the left are network, the bits on the right are host. This would be a completely invalid subnet mask because of that 192. Now, if I rearrange this and I do 255.255.192.0, is that valid? Yes, it is. And because we have bits here, and we have some bits here, we immediately know that this is a subnetted network because we're not showing default bits here. So is this a class A address, or is this a class B address, or is this a class C address? All right, well, let's go through and see if we can determine that. Is it a class A address? Unsubnetted. No, it is not, because if it were, it would be a 0 here, a 0 here, and a 0 here. So this number could actually be a class A network with 2 bits barred. If you look up here, I'm sorry, 8 bits barred plus 2 bits barred here for 10 bits barred. So a class A 10 bits barred, or this could be a class B 2 bits barred. So you got to consider the default numbers here. Can this be a class C? No, because a class C address would have to be 255 here, and that is a default class C network. But what if I put this number in here? So now what is this? Is this a class A, a class B, or a class C? Well, guess what? It's all three, because on a class A, the default bits are 8. We have more bits here. If this were a class A, I mean, it can be a class, not E, but A. The default is 8. So if this were matched up with a class A network number, then we can determine that 8 bits were barred here, 8 bits were barred here, and 3 bits were barred here. See? Add up this, this, and this, you get 224, 3 bits. So, this can also be a class B address. A class B address has default bits of 16. So, this would be the default part for class B. But if this subnet mask were matched up with a class B address, then we would know that 8 bits were barred here and 3 bits were barred here for a total of 11 bits that were barred. And it can be a class C address. The default for class C is 24. Well, we have the 24 here. So if this is a class C, if this subnet mask is matched up with a class C IP address, then we can say that this is a class C address with 3 bits barred. And then we'll come back up here. We said if this were a class B, this would be 8, 9, 10, 11 bits barred. Oops. If this were a class A, then it would be 8, 16, 19 bits barred. I hope this helps you understand the subnet mask. But anytime you see a subnet mask that is representative in any octic that's other than a number other than 255, you have to know that that network has been subnetted. If the network has not been subnetted, then it will always be representative of default bits. So let me change this one here to 0. So what is this? Has this network here been subnetted? Well, you can't answer that question. And the reason you can't answer that question is just like what we just said. It could be a Class A address with 16 bits barred. It could also be a Class B address with 8 bits barred. Or it could be a C address with no bits barred, meaning not subnetted. So looking at a subnet mask, you really can't determine exactly what you're working with until you see the network address that goes with it, or the IP address that goes with it. So for the exercise that's coming up that you're going to be doing, let's do a few more examples of valid and invalid addresses. A subnet mask of 0.0.255.255, valid or invalid? Well, it's invalid. Why is it invalid? Because the network bits are zeros. Zeros represent host bits. So if this were a valid subnet mask, then it would have to be written as 255.255.0.0. But having the zeros in the front make it invalid. What if I have 255.224.128.0? Valid or invalid? Well, it's invalid. The reason it's invalid is because the left side represents networks, so that means that I can't bar a few bits from one octet and then another bit from another octet. When you bar bits, you bar them up until you can't bar anymore, and then you move into the next octet. So this is invalid. What would make this valid is if I change this number to 255. All right, let's see if I have a number like 128.255.0.255. Valid or invalid? Immediately, it's invalid. And I know it's invalid because a subnet mask can't start with 128. The first octet of any subnet mask is always going to be 255. So that makes it invalid. I can also look and tell that this has to be a 255. It can't be a 0 or any other number. It can't be 192, for instance. So let's see. Is this a valid subnet mask? Yes. And that subnet mask represents a Class A default subnet mask. What about this? Valid or invalid? It is valid because you got 255, 255, 255, 240. This gives you an indication that whatever class address it is, that in the last octet we barred 4 bits. Alright, is this a valid subnet mask? No, it is not because of the 245. Typo or Cisco is trying to trick you, one or the other, but it is invalid. It is not a valid subnet mask. Let's do a couple more and then we're going to wrap it up. Hex math. Let me ask you this question. Is this a valid subnet mask? And the answer you might say is yes, because all F's in an octet, if you convert hex to decimal, is going to be 255.255.255.255. Well, if I converted this into a decimal number and I looked at this as being a subnet mask, is it a valid subnet mask? And the answer to that is yes. This is a major broadcast number, which means that if a network needs to send a broadcast to all hosts on all LAN segments at the same time, it's going to flood the network with broadcast, and it's going to flood each subnet, so that means everybody's going to hear it. But if I stated a subnet mask in this format, that is invalid, because subnet mask and IP addresses are logical numbers. They are decimal numbers. They are not ever represented in hexadecimal format. So if I asked you this question, would this be valid or invalid? The answer is it's invalid. What about if I did 255.255.FFF.0, valid or invalid, because we don't state subnet mask in hex values, so the F's immediately make it invalid. All right, I hope this helps you. If it does not help you, and you want more explanation, please call me, email me, Moodle message me, or come to our chat sessions on Tuesday and Thursday nights, and I'll do my best to try to help you get cleared up on it. We're graduating towards IP addressing, so if you understand everything that we talked about in this video, then you're on the right track. If you kind of understand it and you're a little cloudy, that's okay. At this point, I just want you to be able to identify a valid or an invalid subnet mask. We will work towards getting you cleared up. So this is a progression. So if you hang on each time we do more of this network math, I promise you, when we get to the subnetting part of this, you're going to be like, oh, okay, yeah, that makes sense. So good luck on that assignment. The assignment I put down is being due on, I think I put Monday as the due date, but I think I'm going to change that. So look in Moodle for the due date on this assignment, but it will be before, I'll probably change it to maybe Wednesday, to have you turn everything in on Wednesday. So anyway, it's not a long assignment. It shouldn't take you long at all after you've watched this video. So good luck with everything, and I'll see you in the chat, or either I'll see you in another video.